Okay, welcome everyone. Welcome everyone for this last plenary session, actually the last session before the party. And everybody knows that the HISP community loves partying, but are also very good at it. So look forward, and this one we are stepping it up because it's 30 years anniversary. But before we start... But before we start, we just want to send some thoughts to the Malawian population, country, and the group, Malawian group that is here. As you have followed the news, the vice president of Malawi, plus 8 people, died in the crash. So we have warm condolences from the DHS2 community to the Malawian population, and of course the Malawian group that is here. Okay, so then we are switching gear from condolences to celebration. So we are here now wanting to share a bit of our proud history when it comes to how did we build this network? How have we been able to support 88 over ministries of health with doing health information systems and now education, agriculture, climate health and others? How has we been able? So we would like now to do, as a joint effort, try to portray the history with stories, how it all started, and with the people that were part of the starting, and all the HISP group's representatives will eventually end up at the stage in a historical sequence. However, sometimes we might mix it a bit, so beware with me, and then I will try to manage Jørn and Kalle and the rest, which all of you knows that's a bit difficult. But we will tell stories from the history, and we will start with Jørn coming up on the stage. Oh! And I will just tell also, I mean, even though he's very shy, we also have NORAD in the room, and we all know from the opening 4 days back that NORAD has supported us from the very beginning. But it all started in 1994. How did it start, Jørn?
Well, no, I mean, the reason why it's sometimes good to look back is that it might bring some lessons for the future. And I think that is what I just want to repeat here, that it's for the future. We are actually learning from the past. And yes, how it started, I mean, there are some key issues. One thing is that we started based on something we called Scandinavian approach to information system, which is actually based by our professor Kristen, who died a couple of decades back, but it was starting here, and it was about bottom-up development, community-driven development, participatory design, looking at the information system as both being social and technical, and the socio-technical approach. So that was one part of it. And then I started with my PhD and defining my PhD, and that was actually together with this Chris Nygaard. So I was looking for cases, and it was action research. And at the same time, I was actually working in Tanzania, and we developed this idea about the district-based information system and applied to NORAD, but that didn't really work. And then we've tried many places. But then I met in a conference in Nigeria key people from the new South Africa or coming South Africa Minister of Health, and some of these comrades from the exile who had turned home. And they invited me to South Africa, and there, because what was the idea with my PhD research was to focus on district health systems. I tried many places, but and action research, but that was difficult to kind of implement alone. So discussing with these South Africans, because in ANC health plan, the district health system was kind of the foundation, and information was part of it, and then also equity, which was the bearing principle. So that's what's actually how it started. We made a proposal, and with with these people in Cape Town, University of Cape Town, and what was called something like, I mean, the Western Cape Reconstruction, etc.
University of Western Cape?
University of Cape Town first, and then University of Western Cape also. So that was actually the start of it. And then we had already from my effort with Tanzania, we had a proposal to NORAD, and they were so-so. We worked with the Minister of Foreign Department, and they promised to support South Africa. So when we came up with the proposal, then they said that is good. But you see, now Mandela has taken over. It's no longer in the Foreign Department. It's in NORAD. So now you have to talk with NORAD. And then kind of it started, but eventually NORAD supported the project. It started in Cape Town, in three pilot districts there. And I think what I really want to see is how this start in South Africa, where the focus was on equity, how that is actually forming the approach. I mean, it formed the DHIs, which Kalle will talk about quite soon. And it was about getting data from standardized data from the different parts of the country to then measure achievements towards equity. So what is interesting is, of course, to see to what extent today these old principles of equity and bottom-up development, etc., to what extent they are surviving in the modern HISP. Because when we developed DHIs in the old days, everything was about measuring indicators across racial groups, ethnicities, geographical areas, etc. But of course, when you do tracker today, you're not really focusing in the same way on how to use the data to achieve something good. So that is something we need to I think, lessons from South Africa that we need to bring forward. And that is the ethical part, I mean, also the drive towards equity and bottom-up development. And we started, I mean, the software development in South Africa started a little slowly. And we started with asking people to develop their own system, bottom-up, very, very, too much bottom-up. But then Kalle came up with this very, very good prototyping of the DHIS version 1. And now we will ask Kalle, I think,
Kalle,
to come up here.
And come up. And then Kalle can say a few words about how it all started from Kalle's point of view. Then we have... And now we are talking DHIS 1.
Yeah, now we're talking efforts by management to control the speakers, and that never works with me. No, listen, when I came to South Africa to do a PhD on designing information systems for supporting land reform, which turned out to be very difficult because the land reform process in South Africa was a mess, and it's still a mess. So by chance, I was asked to assist Jørn and the other guys, and I said, all right, I can do that. I was having a year as a sabbatical, preparing my PhD proposal, etc. And in reality, I had to use my PhD money. I got a four-year grant from the Norwegian Research Foundation, and I used that to get the whole thing started. Because UCT, I remember, they paid me like $1,000 over 4 years, which I used to have parties for trainees and other participants, you know, that I was training. I think the critical thing about the DHIS 1 was that it was done there. And you see, I put on an African shirt here because I've lived and worked in Africa for 30 years. It would never have worked without the development, including me, actually being there. So if I had been one of these consultants, you know, parachuting in every 2 months from Norway, it wouldn't have worked. Not initially. Now the HISP community, DHIS community, is a global community. Then it wasn't, and we had to be on the ground. And initially, we got a lot of pepper for, hey, these guys, they are even fixing paper forms. My goodness, when management were talking about, you know, unified system, not in the cloud, but up in the cloud somewhere. And I still remember the head director at the national department. He had the same set of slides for 15 years. He just added to them. I think he had about 170 slides at the beginning, but almost none of it. Telemedicine, all of these dreams were not coming through. So 90% of the capital, the intellectual capital behind the DHIS, and that includes most of the features which are still a core features of DHIS 2 and still successful and still the best performing ones for aggregated data. That intellectual capital came from the users. And my role was mostly to actually sort of bring in that prototyping thinking, that user participation thinking, respect users, and always trying to incorporate what was coming from the ground. And you know, that worked, and we gave it away to people. Again, here, funny story, you know, I look at a passive from Nigeria, I was mentioning it here. We used to, for 15 years, write CDs and give to people the latest software, including the latest databases, often cleaned up and whatever. And I had Americans and Europeans coming in laughing about these primitive guys down there, right? And they were pointing to their own websites. And I would say, well, you have wonderful websites, but you have no activity on the ground, no data. So we actually developed things organically, slowly. We had very little money, but that also meant the corrupt, you know, people in the system were not really interested in what we were doing. So we were able to actually work and develop things organically. And I think that also became the basis for the whole community. Just one final comment is that something we've lost on the way. I've been thinking, you know, about what I've heard at this conference here. We were much stronger on using information for local action in those years. We were much more focused on how are people experiencing the health sector. Lots of that we've lost. I haven't heard anything. You know, we talk about AI and machine learning and all kinds of things, very interesting, but we've actually lost our ability to work with people. We work too much, and nothing wrong with people in ministries, but we work too much with ministries and with the top brass and too little with the people that is actually affected by the health sector. And I hope we can start changing that, because at the end of the day, what matters is the people and not the ministers.
Thank you, Kalle. Thank you. Thank you. You might sit. You would like to sit? You both of you can sit, actually. So that was the beginning. So from 94, 96, developing DHS 1 throughout the whole South Africa in 2000-ish, it was scaled for the whole South Africa, and the Africa came after. And what happened after that in with the, his community and his network was that we started not only exploring or utilizing Kalle's and Jørn's actually scholarships, PhD scholarships. We continued with our friends, NORAD, our new friends at that time, with NORAD coming up with stipend program on masters and PhDs. So then, other countries, we have 6 PhD scholarships from Mozambique. Can Emilio come up? Already in 2000. So Emilio was from that batch. And then it's not only for PhD students, it was also for master students. Then I will call up Severino. And that was Mozambique with the 6 PhD students and also master students. But then, of course, Severino, he don't go anywhere without Tibonge. And actually, and I didn't know that it was Malawi. I always thought it was Mozambique, but it was Malawi because of all the badge of the PhD student. It was Malawi that was the first country outside South Africa using DHS. Not 2, 1. I need to learn this one. And then, of course, we continue with this style you see now, the university collaboration, the building in, tapping into people's education, meaning master and PhDs, that was laid the ground for the whole HISP network. So after this one, we also have Tanzania and Ethiopia. master program was also made there. So we need the Maleke. Maleke, are you here? Said, are you here? Abiot? Yeah, come on. Up with you. Ethiopia was also part of this stipend program from NORAD. And it was all, not only the stipend program, but also the NUMA, no, NUFU. NOMA was later, that was taking over in the tent or something. So that, then we also need Tanzania to come up. Who's from Tanzania here without Wilfred? Wilfred, he was not even born at that time.
Honest was supposed to be.
But Mr. Tanzania is representing Tanzania. Tanzania was also making a master program there, and we have master students from there. So this, you can see, when we are looking into it, that laid the ground for all the HIST groups coming later. That was all started by a university collaboration. We need to bring Pamud also up from Sri Lanka, because Sri Lanka was also a master program, even though later. But it's very, very important. Same program-ish. Pamud, can you please come? And so these guys, you will see in the end, we have a gender problem. So these guys were the start of the network, starting with the university. But then India came along. John, Saurabh, where's Saurabh now? There's Saurabh. Woohoo! Then John, can you tell a bit about the start of the, Mike is here, a bit of the start of the India adventure.
Actually, again, it was a DHIS2-1. It started in Kuppam, in a very small place. DHIS1. Yes.
Can I just tell that John went in the same class and the batch as Tivonga, as a master student, just so you know. So this is continuum of this university collaboration. And Seferino, sorry, in the same class.
And we started in 2000 in a small place called Kuppam in Andhra Pradesh. I was a very young guy with a mustache, pre-globalization. If I show you the photograph of me being there, you will never recognize. And it was true. Even the Tanzanian Zanzibar people didn't recognize me when I lost my passport. Yeah, so we started with a small place. And then, as Kale mentioned, I was a small developer doing with DHIS2-1 and trying to build a standard report with the people in the each PHC, which is a primary healthcare center. And like install DHIS in 7 places, have my Luna going around to one hospital, to other hospital, to other hospital, because we had only one printer. So connect the printer to the hospital and make the printout, and so the medical officer can sign. So that's how we started in India. And then like we grow to district and state, and then we went to the national level and created the HISP.
But he was very dedicated, the only person I know who go to sleep with his laptop.
I still do now.
I'm sure his wife is pissed.
I had to change when I had my kid, because like it was very hard to have my laptop next to my kid. So
too hard, actually, literally too hard.
Yeah. So after that one, we went to the HISP India at the national level, and then now HISP Asia Hub.
And John normally say, I'm born and raised at the University of Oslo, master and then later PhD. But then we all, not only talking about our successes, we also need to talk a bit about our failures, Cuba. But who can be successful in Cuba? Not even us. Not even us waiting for 3 decades, we are successful. And then we have Johanna Nola, come up on the stage. And I need to say that Johan and Ola, the first time I heard about Johan and Ola was from our father, our dead father. He was so engaged in Cuba. He even learned Spanish to be part of the implementation in Cuba. Johan and families stopped schools and everything, was on their way to Cuba. And Kolbjørn, our father, said always, my boys. And the boys, they are Ola and Johan.
Thanks, Kristin. Yeah, thanks for calling us on the failure. I think I think it was George W. Bush Sr. that was the cause of the failure. starting a blockade and defining Cuba as part of Axis of Evil, and then they wanted to kick out all foreigners, including Norwegians, unfortunately. But we had a lot of fun in Cuba. I think we did a lot of good work. Maybe one story, Kalle, is I know many of our developers here have been struggling with all of Kalle's bug reports. I can say that when we implemented, was it DHIS 1.2, I think 2 something in Cuba, Johan and I, we didn't even always have access to email. So we were sending fax to Kalle with the bugs, and then we would receive a response, we modify this line, modify this line. And that's how we kind of worked. And it wasn't always responsive, but most of the time, Kalle was also dedicated, not even sleeping. I don't think you even slept, Kalle. I think you were sitting by that big computer in Cape Town all the time. Johan?
Yeah, not much more to add. Great to be a failure again. I'm just coming from master examinations and made me reflect a bit on our stay in Cuba, because we were there as master students. And of course, when you do your bachelor here in the Department of Informatics, you learn how to code. Then you go into UML and modeling and all that. Our master's experience then with Jørn in Cuba was immensely refreshing. I mean, it's one place we learned, I mean, yes, wrote, painting with a broad pencil, but we or broad brush, we learn how to change the world. And that was, I think, for me, very, very important for how I related to technology and what we could do. So here we are still trying to do that step by step.
And the wonderful thing with our network, nobody's leaving. Selle, are you here? He left, but no, not left. Are you here, Selle? Come. Because Zanzibar is also important for our history. Some are leaving, but they come back. So Zanzibar is very important, because when you heard about this DHS-1, DHS-2, and there have been a 3, but then Zanzibar, DHS-4, and 1.4, sorry, 1.4. But the 1.4 was then an attempt to be more generic, supporting more countries, not only the English language and South Africa, but also being able to use more languages, but also be more generic. So that's kind of on its way to be a bit more multi-purpose, multi-country, generic platform software. We are software there. And we also have to say that Ola then was more successful than Jørn going to Cuba with the family. He took his whole family to Zanzibar, and that was, I guess, a pretty good choice.
Tough life, yeah. Maybe just a short story. We can talk more about the bugs, Kalle. But I mean, Zanzibar, I guess Jørn was the first country to pilot 1.4. So it was very interesting. I live just across the street from the ministry and the HMIS unit, in kind of a bunker container kind of office there. I spent most of the time there with this man, Selle, who was then one of the many IT guys in the HMIS unit. And I think we worked day and night in there to improve the DHIS 1.4 implementation. So it was a pleasure to work with you, Selle, and I'm really glad you're still around and supporting DHIS.
Yeah, thank you very much. I mean, it wasn't easy in Zanzibar, because, you know, it was 1.4, and most of the time, even the internet accessibility, it wasn't there. So you have to move all around the district, but the good thing is you can move around 60 districts just in the 2 hours, you know? Yeah, because Zanzibar is too small. But the good thing is when you have a place which is too small, sometimes to see the positive results, it become very easy. So, yeah.
And then Zanzibar is, as according to Tanzania, it's part of the mainland. Yeah, of course. Because that's why Prosper always said nobody wants to come to Uganda, because there's no beaches. you know, we are very, very happy with beaches, okay? But then pilots happened in mainland Tanzania as well, in Bagamoyo and Kibaha at the same time. So how Tanzania was scaling, that will come later. But Nigeria is next. Aluka, come. Yoo-hoo. First DHS 1, but then in 12, DHS 2.
Yeah. Thank you. I think we are grateful to Kala and mostly to Otto Haywood, because as at the time DHIS got to Nigeria, we were using an AP-Info software called Haifa. And so when Kala got, Otto got project from the DFID, he now had worked with DHIS and decided to invite Kala to come down. When Kala came, we could work 3 days, 4 days with the ministry without getting any data from the Haifa. And so we started with DHIS 1.3, and then we went on. So by 2010, although we were under the tutelage of the South African team, we decided to, because the country was big, going from one place to the other became an issue. So we decided to go to version 2, which was a web base. And so the first academy in Tanzania at Beach Komba was the one that we went there with the idea of getting our Nigerian data file. And since then, we have been there. Thank you.
Good, good, good. For the history.
They sent the sort of a guard with me. The deputy director was sent with me to watch over what I was doing. But after a week, remember, they had this Haifa system. They had a warehouse full of registers or whatever. We're trying to collect 12,000 different data elements. And after 5 years, they had no data. No data whatsoever. So that deputy director, after a week of actually seeing DHIS in action, he was convinced that this was the way to go. And I think, again, it wouldn't have been possible if it had been a traditional story with, you know, a tender and companies tendering and whatever. We could actually give them what we had, show them how to use it, and they actually bought into it. And I think more than anything else in Africa, that has been the reason why the DHS has been spreading, because people could try it out without having to go through any kind of commercial contracting. Thanks.
Thank you, Kala. So this grassroots movement of DHS2 network and HISP network, we have never been good in tendering, but good in doing. So now we're going into a new era, which is Vietnam, 2004. Vietnam become a software partner, and in a meeting, an event going to Vietnam, Jørn and Ola was there, and Jørn was saying, we need some free workforce. We need to make an open source course at University of Oslo so we can get some developers. And that happened. So Jørn and Ola was then making that. Do you want to say something about the Vietnam software time?
You can just, no?
Should we call up the students from that first batch of...
That I'm about to say them. So Ola and Jørn made that course, and the first student was...
I'm not sure Jørn made it.
Yeah, Jørn didn't make much, but he had the idea. of course. Import. But then in the first batch, Lars Øverland, Markus, Knut Staring, he was actually at that time already a PhD student, and he needed some grades for his PhD program, so he became a student also. Isn't that true, Knut? Now you remember. Ola, I remember, actually. He didn't remember.
Yeah. Yeah, Jørn is very good at getting free labor. That's one of his key skills. Yeah. And I just want to say, before we had the formal education, I think we had a lot of informal education as well, because since Kala is here, I was staying with Kala for many years in his house in Cape Town, and that was invaluable source of information. So we got all these goodies from 1.4. And Kalle, of course, claims that everything in the HS2 has been there in one forever. So that it's all, it was all in there, right? And but it's kind of true. It's a lot of the same principles. And I was fortunate enough to be with Kalle for a long time, to learn from his expertise and ask him questions. The problem is, of course, the answer might take the entire day. So you got to be a bit patient, but there's a lot to learn. So we learned a lot. And then I guess we started the open source course. Yeah. So we had a course, and then usually Jörn says, yeah, just go teach something, do something. It'll sort it out, you know. And then I think we took the course ourselves, and the next year we had to actually teach the same course.
And that became the HS2, huh? In
2005-ish. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So we kind of started. We created slides and material for all the frameworks that we use in the HS2. We had to teach it to people, and it actually became the most popular course in IFE.
And it still is. It still is, actually. Now it's, of course, platform ecosystem, you know, blah, blah, blah. It still is the biggest, the most popular master program course since 2005.
Yep.
And that's DHS2.
Yep, not bad. And Marcus was also there. You want to say something?
I still remember we were walking down the aisle and looking for a master's project together. We felt that we were a very good group from our bachelors, and we were walking down talking to different people, and we met this guy. I remember it still. Sitting there, dangling your feet on a table and talking about the world that sounded very, very different than our own. And I'm so glad that we chose to start in your project, Knut, and maybe you want batch. To.
It was the best batch we got. We were very lucky, actually, because it's all thanks to Bologna. I don't know if most of you know this Bologna process, where they actually changed to the bachelor plus masters. So all the people who came from these colleges all over Norway suddenly could start on a master's in at the university. So we got a huge crop of people, and they were very good. So here we are, thanks to Bologna.
So going from South Africa to the rest of the Southern Africa to East Africa to West Africa, Adam. I mean, Nigeria is West Africa. Sorry. Francophone West Africa. And now we are talking about Sierra Leone. We are talking about the Accra meeting, WoW collaboration, HMN. Over to you, Adam.
Yeah. before the Sierra Leone project, I had the opportunity to meet Jörn. I think it was in Brussels through a common friend, an activist actually. And then he tried to connect us to ask us to work together. It was, in 2006, December. And then we said, okay, let's see how we can work together. We talked about DHS2. And then I said, okay, at that time I was in Mali working on telemedicine's project. And I said, maybe we can do something in Mali. So I went back, I started working on a project for mobile reporting using DHS2. And then a few months later, Jörn called me to say, there is something in Sierra Leone. Do you have availability? Can you go to Sierra Leone to work on a project starting with an assessment? I said, okay, why not? We can go. But my English is not that good. He said, no, don't worry. I think you can manage. So, and then I think it was in July, yes, 2007. Then we went together to Sierra Leone for the initial assessment. The project was about integrating CRIS and DHS2. So if today you are wondering whether the project have technical focus, then it's nothing new. Even back in the 2007, it was still the focus. People are thinking on technical things. So we went there, we conducted the assessment, and it was a great opportunity for me to actually literally see information system from the Stone Age to the computerized one. Because when we went there, we were able to see, for instance, in a village where a woman had a good information system based on stones, because she was tallying the cases in a box using stones. So, and then we look at everything, we came back and we said, okay, now let's work on a proposal. So, and then Yon say, given the context, it will be better to have a prototype, a good prototype to show to people what can be possible. And then we sat together, we brought data that we have. I think we connected also with Knut to get some data online. He sent it. And then we set up the prototype. We went there and we showed it to the people in the continent. They say, wow, this is the first time we are able to do cross-analysis between program data and so
forth. Without stones.
Yes, of course.
And then Jan and Johan was also part of that. Jan, are you here? Brother? No? No, Øverland Jan is not there, but Johan is. So no need to talk. No. This, not everyone can talk.
Leon. It's Jan. We were actually funded by CRISP and the UNAIDS in Geneva, and that's the only time we have been a bit maybe not fully ethical, because who did we meet down there? We came with CRISP, and CRISP, they thought that since we were having facility data, their district data could integrate with DHI, so they didn't understand anything. Aggregate, they have an aggregate by district, this CRISP. But when we were there, we met the whole delegation from HMN. That was 2007, and HMN had just started. And then we organized a workshop based on the UNAIDS money, also for HMN. And then this Geneva UNAIDS understood that we were actually selling out, are using their project to kind of involve HMN. And they said, no, we will not pay for the workshop. And then it was kind of like that until the day before the workshop. And they said, okay, they said that, okay. And then HMN made, after that, since it was so fantastic, this DHIS, they made Sierra Leone their kind of priority pilot project. So that was based on some dirty tricks, Adam.
But can you just mention also the Accra meeting?
Accra meeting was a bit later, that Bob was also there, if I'm not remembering wrongly. It was something WHO and also CDC and others, they called it the open source toolkit. And it was this Iris, and it was DHIS, and some different softwares. And it was a very nice conference in Accra. And what the story point is that Tomika from WHO, West Africa Health Organization, he was there and heard about, we had actually implemented DHIS in Sierra Leone. I mean, that was not far long after the civil war. And he said, if it's possible to implement DHIS in Sierra Leone, it will be possible all over West Africa.
And he happened to be true.
Also.
Happened to be true. Manya, can you come up? Because the next very, very important point was Kenya. Kenya. And apropos Kalle talking about being there, the whole software team was there. To try to implement the DHIS 2 in Kenya. Four people, whole team was four people, because at that time we just got funding from NORAD, we got core funding. So when we're talking about 30 years anniversary, we could also talk about 30 years struggle for funding. We got our first funding in 2010. And we had money to pay salaries for Ola, Lars, Morten, and Jan. And they went to Kenya. And they went to Kenya to solve, to scale DHS2 for Kenya. And the key learning from Kenya. Who will tell that story, Lars or Manya?
No, I think I just want to make one confession. And then I'll give it to Lash. When we started DHIS2, I asked Yon, where is our data? And he told us, up there, in the clouds. Cloud computing was just maybe starting. So I actually, up to now, I'm still wondering how data would sit on the clouds. And so for the first time, although I really talk so much ill about people who make decisions without information, I made a decision to host our data on the clouds without knowing what was cloud computing.
Yeah, I mean, I think for once, like we were a bit lucky with the timing for Kenya. I remember Jörn and I, we went on a, district field trip to kind of work with the end users and get feedback straight from the districts. And we sat there and typed in data on the online cloud DHIST. And then suddenly, of course, power went out. You know, it's like boom, dark. And then we thought, okay, that's it. You know, we got to go home now and like get in the car. And suddenly the guy just like turns up his laptop, takes his dongle from his shirt, and injects the mobile dongle, like the Safaricom one, into his laptop and like continues to type as if nothing happened. He was like, what? What just happened? And this was like totally normal for these guys. But this was a time when sort of mobile internet came to East Africa. And I would say that was really a success factor for us. It was a good timing. Timing was right. And it really enabled us to scale quickly. And I remember that since we kind of mimicked the paper forms in DHIS too, people started capturing data without any training. Like people just entered data. We gave them like the URL and the username and the password. And then 2 days later, the data was in. I mean, they haven't even done any training. So it was like really easy to scale. And I think that was a trick. It was easy, simple, online, and people had mobile internet. And it scaled very, very quickly. Of course, we had trainings, but it scaled very quickly.
And that started the revolution in a way, because we had a, the academy started already in Dar in 11, but however, the very, very framing conference and academy in Mombasa in 12, then all the countries then learned from Kenya, what Kenya was able to do in very short time, going online for the scaling to the whole country with mobile internet and cloud services, that created a lot of inspiration and aspiration. And I have to tell, when Claude, the Minister of Health, is still working in the Minister of Health, our very dear friend, he was traveling with me, Manya and Jörn to visit facilities, do you remember? And then he was asked, so when did you start with DHS2? He was asked, oh, back in the 2006 or whatever, and you're still scale. And he was so embarrassed, and he went home, and it took 1 year, and then DHS2 was scaled in the whole country using mobile internet in Tanzania as well. So, but not only Tanzania, but other countries like Uganda. Come, Prosper. Rwanda. Adolf, are you here? Adolf here? No? Okay. And Ghana was scaling very fast, inspired by the success and the speed and the exposure in the academy. And then we learned that academies, you all know about the academies, this is not an academy, this is a conference, but all about the academy, we thought it was training. No, it's inspiration, learning south-south. Inspiration and aspiration, what is possible. And then all the countries in that conference went home for implementing and doing the same.
Yeah. Yeah, so just before that, to mention that Kara was my lecturer at Western Cape for DHIS21. So I went into the network before then. But the story for Uganda was really an amazing one, because after learning from Kenya, we actually used Kenya to come and train us to start, and Ula and the team. But what was very impressive in Uganda was that we were able to roll out in 4 months and covering the entire country, just 4 months. Everybody, every district, 120 districts were up and running. But without analytics, Scott, the analytics that we only had was the reports, which many people don't use right now. Reports, My Data Mart, we were talking about My Data Mart, and somebody was like, what is that? The key thing for Uganda, HISP Uganda, has been really a source of ideas to be able to to stress the developers here. For Uganda, that's where we started the SMS idea and tested and implemented there. The first logistic system with LAS for ARVs, for PEPFAR was also in that period and generating reports, and went on the case-based surveillance for the global health security and the EMIS for the education also in that. So it's been quite an interesting area for learning. I may say we've not have been able to scale most of these things so widely, but it has really informed the way DHIS2 has been developing.
Thank you, Prosper. I think Dana, come, Ola, where are you? Come on, here. Ola, wait, please. You see my...
Look it up. Okay, so then we have Ghana, and the fun story is a bit different with Ghana because Olav, did you come? Yeah, Olav is there. He don't want to say anything. It's come. No, it can be over there if you want to. The support for Ghana is Oswald, Ghana Health Services, but also the last HISP group from this year. Clap, you can clap. We are doing timeline, but however, we want to just mention the easiness that Olav's master project was to support the scaling of DHS2 for the whole Ghana. That was his master project, I'm just saying that. And that also creates a lot of inspiration. Is it that easy to do that in a country? That was also kind of a key learning for countries. And Prosper was mentioning the mobile projects and utilizing mobile. We have to say that in 2010-11, we started the DHS2 for mobile with extensive studies in Nigeria, in India, with implementation and the whole community. We met all of us. Ismail, are you here? Ismail, he was then, just think about how young he was at that time. He was then an aspiring master student. We have Marta later coming in. I mean, that's the second generation of the mobile project. Marta, come. Marta. Because she, as a result, some generation later, the Android team was formed. Rangari Rai, are you here? Do we see Ranga? Oh, he's because he's DJing, so we will talk to Ranga later. Rangari Rai, he was the only PhD student that was, we had to pay for his DJ equipment for him to come to Norway. It's true. So this makes all sense. Huh? So this, they're just for mobile. We also, actually, Jason was the first time we met Jason, because he had this mobile project in Zambia, and we all met in Vietnam on the mobile academy, very, very good hosting from Hung, from his Vietnam. And that was also very framing for the community feeling that we were all there working on how can we support DHS2 with whatever you have in the pocket, whether it's SMS, feature phones, later Android. SMS still work. We still need SMS for really outreach services. So Zimbabwe could be mentioned, but Rangari Rai is outside warming up. But Zimbabwe was where we had the largest mobile project and also become a HISP group in 23. So the growing network, now we are speeding up, people thinking about the time, but you're speeding now up on the growing network because now it's happening a lot. Bangladesh, we are only in 13. Hanan. Of course, winning all the competition when they come the largest scale of any system, the largest tracker, the largest implementation of whatever DHS2 implementation. And then Indonesia, 14. Rati, can you come up? Indonesia is very, very interesting. Do you want to? Rati's not here. Okay. So they are not in the room, but it's very, very interesting because it was starting as a dashboard and a data use project. And then we have the first Latin America HISP group formed. In 2013, the first Spanish-speaking academy, facilitated by the two over in the corner here, the very Spanish speaker, Knut, speak whatever language, but Marta more natural, however, supporting the Latin America implementations. Colombia, Marco, are you here? Marco is here, of course. Good, good, good. Welcome, welcome. Come on the stage. But then maybe Adam could say something about the West African growth of activities that started off as becoming partners on the West and Central Africa, but lately, last year, becoming his groups. You want to say something about the DRC, Mali, Cote d'Ivoire?
Yeah. In fact, we started as HISP West and Central Africa, supporting many countries at that time because we didn't have a lot of implementers. And then as the number of countries are growing and also the demands are also coming in countries and so forth, and then there were people asking, why can't we have the local HISP group, or we need more support in the countries and so forth. And then at the same time, in Mali, for instance, there was this major evaluation project supporting the DHS implementation, and the project was ending. There was no one there to support. And we said, okay, why not set up a team there to keep the WOP and keep the DHS to up and running? And that's how we started working with Ismail and his team, and the Ismaili team was set up.
Ismail, come on the scene. Mali. Patty, are you here? Patty, DRC?
Hmm? Patty, yeah, he's coming.
Yeah, coming. Yeah.
Oh, so
yeah.
For yeah, so for Patty, as you know, DRC is like a subcontinent, and the demand there is very huge. They have a lot of programs, a lot of partners working on DHS-related activities, and we said, okay, maybe it's time to have a permanent basis in DRC. And then we work together with Patty and his team to set up also his DRC.
Super, thank you. Then we're going more big countries, but also in population, Pakistan, Adnan. Now we are 2019, we are getting closer. So Pakistan, super big interest, so many projects going on. Very much looking forward to further collaboration with the HISP Pakistan. But then we need to speed up a bit. Then Palestine. Mohammed. All of our eyes and thoughts and support are by Gaza. And our peers. So the his MENA is new. His MENA is from last year, but the work in Palestine started already in 14. 14 with Mike, Marcus. Mike, come. Together with the Public Health Institute and WHO, working on supporting Palestine and Gaza, West Bank to have a Public Health Institute, but also the first tracker implementation. So the whole tracker was in a way made as Palestine as a use case for maternal and child health registry and system. So that's kind of thanks to the implementations in Gaza and West Bank, the tracker was kind of having the birth. Then, nice to have you back. So Mohammed was also part of that one, but then working in the WHO. So that's what I'm saying. Nobody is leaving. Okay, the HISP group's presentation is a bit over, but we need to talk about partners and investments. And I'm looking a bit serious. I'm talking about the struggle to convince partners that DHS2 is a global good. DHS2 as a core need to be supported in order to be able to support 88 countries. And look at these guys. And we have 60-ish developers also supporting all the countries there is. So the most important. I know that Nora never want to go to the stage, so you can sit where you are. But the three-party agreement formed in 2013 by NORAD, Global Fund, and PEPFAR was extremely important. And actually, we laid the way for the whole DPG, Digital Global Public Good, work. And so they to be able to have these three partners, and we have partner meeting and investors all them every year. And in the, they recruited more and more and more people. But now we see a tendency to going the other way. How can we support, why should we send all our money to UIO when we can support countries? Do you want to comment there?
No, actually, I wanted to have Sam from Laos to come to the stage.
Yeah, because Sam, because you're not a his group, you're under his Vietnam. Sam, please, Lao. Can Sam also come? So, talking about the struggle to become, to have people to support the platform, because when we have this successful conference with the nearly 400 participants, you might believe that we are loaded in money and there is a lot of interest to finance us with all success in all these countries. It's not really the true, nearly true. Because even though, no, I see that from my script, I've forgotten one thing. The beauty of having a group of investors is actually during the pandemic, we were able to mobilize reorganization of the funds, but also new funds, like especially NORAD, to be able to support the pandemic. Sean, I'm seeing you, but is Pamud first say a bit, a couple of sentences about the pandemic work in Sri Lanka? Because the investors made it possible for us to actually mobilize this whole network to support all the countries with all the means we had, all the global resources, and all the good collaboration, the trust, and the sharing of every innovations, we were able to then to support over 60 countries for disease surveillance and vaccine delivery. Pamud, it all started in Sri Lanka.
Yeah. However, the pandemic started, as we all know, in China. So, so the thing is, in January 2020, there was a lot of noise about this rapidly spreading virus, which by then it was called neo-coronavirus. We were all talking about it. It's really rapidly spreading because Sri Lanka, again, is a country in South Asia with tourism and all that. We were worried. So that's when we were able to have this informal discussion with the Ministry of Health. And that was made possible based on something that was initiated more than a decade ago. So as Christine mentioned initially, in 2009, it was possible. Sri Lanka was able to design a master's program in health informatics in University of Colombo. And the products of this master's program, the medical doctors specialized in health informatics, they were in the ministry, national level, as well as districts all around the country. So that's why, I'm glad to see some of them in the audience as well. So with that collaboration and discussions, we were able to design something within like days. Initially to monitor the port of entry, at port of entry, how people are coming. And then this I posted in DHS to Slack. And then with that, we were able to get support from this entire HISP community. There was a lot of feedback. And with all that, in 4 months' time, we were able to develop, the virus was spreading. Pandemic was evolving, so we were evolving and we were able to create so many different modules. And finally, with vaccination, the entire population, adult population of Sri Lanka, around 16 million, we were able to import into DHIS too. Of course, with that, we had a lot of issues related to the performance and all, and that's where the entire community and the UIO was able to help. Yeah.
And all the innovation that was made during that hackathon in March 2020 was shared among the whole network and reused and being bettering and being domesticated for all the speciality for each country. So that's a big hand for that work. So, Sean, can you come up? Because we want to prepare ourselves for the new trends in investments, because the trend is now, we cannot send money for UIO, the trend is sending money to the countries. So what we are doing now, what's new now? Sean, come up. The new now is that we are making two hubs. One HISP Asia, one HISP Africa. I'm just putting Sean up because he's also part of the discussion that we had last week on the HISP Africa hub. How can we then take the collaboration to the next level, utilizing whatever we did during pandemic and we do during climate health, sharing, but also preparing for being able to take part in tenders, because we normally are sole source. We not so many sole source opportunities left. We need to fight together with the others to show that what's happening in the country should stay in the country. The capacity should be in the countries. That's why we have formed two hubs to prepare ourselves to be able to solve the problem of financing going to the countries and being able to use the best capacity we have in the country, because we don't really have server competence in each HISP group. That is kind of distributed a bit. We have many, many competences that are kind of a little bit here and a little bit there, and together we are super strong. Prosper?
Hi, thank you very much, Christine. Standing with my elder, this is HISP South Africa. Our elder, we always look out to HISP South Africa, and in front of the HISP groups here, we want to appreciate Global Fund, Geneva, that started this concept of the hubs. And by then we had three hubs 3 years ago that have done a fantastic job in terms of collaborating the efforts around the health system strengthening in the two regions, in the two continents, that has now led to a merger and the birth of a new baby called HISP Africa. So HISP Africa is a consortium of all the HISP groups here in Africa, working together, collaborating together to deliver and support you as partners, as funders, as clients, as competitors, in a better way that we can be able to deliver and improve the health system strengthening. So a lot is coming, but we want to announce that we are now one and we are working in collaboration, strength each other. As you see the network, wherever there is weakness, we lift up. Wherever there is borrowing and sharing and all that will be what we aim to do in the HISP Africa. So welcome on board HISP Africa.
So that's the newest HISP group. We also have HISP Asia. HISP Asia actually started a couple of years ago, but HISP Africa is actually for this year. So that's really, it should be the last one, but sorry. John.
Yeah, HISP Asia Hub, like we are thankful for Global Fund to organizing this Asia Hub. So we have 7 members. HISP MENA was our last member, joined last year. So I want to announce, I want to take this opportunity to also announce, we have our 3rd HISP Asia conference in October 1st this year. So where we had last year, we had the conference in Sri Lanka, but this year we also are having conference in Vietnam, Da Nang, similar kind of conference, but focusing only on Asia region, where we want to have the challenges and user experience share across with different countries so that we can support each other very well and also collaborate among our HISP group and countries on learning best practices and also not reinventing the same wheel again and again. Yeah, thank you.
Super, thank you. So last but not least, now we are talking about the HISP network, all the HISP group, how it had been formed by education. We all believe in education. We all believe in capacity building in countries. But we shouldn't forget the ministries. So who are we actually supporting? That's the ministries, and it's no matter whether it's education, health, agriculture, but what we are actually doing is to supporting the government. We are working hard, as one of the sessions said, to be a global digital public good, to build this digital public infrastructure, to support the ministries, the government, to be able to handle the challenges, the societal challenges, to be able to govern better and to take better decisions. So that is our actually last word for this before the party starts. And it starts in, oh no, there is a photo first. And Alice will kill me if I didn't tell you. After this one, we are going out. If we can, we can wear the t-shirt. I will try to put the t-shirt on. And then we are doing photography before we can use our coupons. And listen to Ranga and the Senegal band and everything. So, oh, Kalle want to say something?
That you might have made. One is negative, and I'm not talking about that, there's so little hair here. But one is negative, and that is obviously the gender balance, right? And what I can say from knowing many of the his groups is that, you know, in the countries, they are better. But yeah, here it sucks. Yeah. But a positive observation that you might also have made, there is not a single tie insight. And I think actually, I mean, we often don't talk about culture, right? But I think one reason for this community having worked out well is that we are very informal. And I can't even recall having heard anyone within the DHIS2 community tell others that, hey, I got a PhD or you only have a master, so you go and shut up. Or tell them that, yeah, I'm higher than you in the ministry, so you better shut up. So I think no tie, very good. Thank you.
But gender balance, not good.
Thank you, Carl. At one point, I thought you said men tie people. So I was a bit shocked, but it was... I don't even know what a tie is. Sorry, sorry. So thank you so much for listening in to our very long 30 years of history, how we ended up here. And congratulations to all of us. Thank you.